One can call it a wild place, Judy, but my own feeling about wilderness is that it's a place where man can venture to, and he can quit the sort of cloth of normal life. And I think that you can only experience wilderness on your own, where you could sit by the loch side or running water, or you could sit among those great trees. And somewhere in that setting, if you have a failure to communicate with mountain, loch, stream, or trees, then there is nothing I can give you that will help you on the way to wilderness.
A lot of people who are now looking for the good life. The good life was here, without any artificial creation. And we didn't regard it as a good life. It was just the type of existence that was common in the Highlands at that time, but isn't there today. It was a real life that had a purpose. It had a connection to the natural environment, which must have a purpose. It might look romantic from the outside. From the inside, it was a very satisfying and purposeful existence. There's no doubt about that.
I really, in a sense, found myself. I turned my back on what I'd known before. At that point, I could see that the life ahead would always be connected with the hills.
And we're the last people living in Strathmore. We're the last family to live in this croft. Well, what was the croft here?
The Highlands of Scotland. Beauty and emptiness. On August 5, 1943, Parliament passed an act to help solve the problem of the Highlands by developing the great resources of water power now running to waste in these hills. The people of the Highlands expect great things from this plan.
See that spate of water. That's power. And we've more of that water in the Highlands than anywhere else in Britain. We need dams and turbines to turn that water into electric power. And we'll get them now we've an Act of Parliament behind us.
There were Acts of God before there were Acts of Parliament. And the Highlands are an Act of God.
We believed the path of progress in the form of hydroelectricity was a final chapter in the clearance of these great Highland glens. The hills that I lost and left are not happy hills anymore. The hills are sad for the old days, and they won't return.
Thank you. Change doesn't bother me particularly because I accept that there's got to be change. But I think the falling apart of these big buildings must mean something. It was one of the great houses in the Highlands where people came to hunt each year, and everything would gain momentum as the stalking season approached. And the highlight of the stalking season, of course, was moving into September when the stags were at their best. And this was one of the great deer forests. There's a lot of stuff written about Goosehoon Estate and the huge stags that were on the estate. But recently talking to a stalker who worked here, and he said, it was the finest time of my life. One day I was escorting guests on the hill shooting, and the next day I was fishing on the river, he said, and can you think of a better life than that?
The people that lived in this part of the world were quite singular people, and the owners may have been fortunate in owning a piece of the Highlands, but they didn't own the people. Living in this environment, you were your own man. You had to be. And I think the owners, the landowners, the lairds, realized that. We'd ourselves own self-respect because you had to have it to exist here.
The case is very eloquently illustrated by the tragedies of a shepherd, a predecessor of mine in Strathmore, Fachar MacPhail. He was shepherding there at the turn of the century with his wife and family, three children. And the poor man saw his three children die all before they reached maturity. And then ultimately his wife died. And he was left there for the remainder of his days. But he did have the comfort of the hills that he worked on.
Enjoyed my life on my grounds. And when I got my pea, I used to stick it up on the shelf there and without even opening it to see what was inside it. Until my wife would ask her needing some money, and remember it was there. So I think it's nice when one can enjoy their work and that, like that. You've got to be born to it, brought up to it. As long as there's a job to do, you do it regardless of time. You just work away. You've got to do it. Work really from 8 in the morning to 10, 12 at night is necessary to get the job done. It's far better than sitting in the house saying it, you know, as long as you're fit to do it. I wouldn't like to work in a factory, the same thing day in and day out. It's a riot here. See something new every day. Live to be 100 years and you're still learning on the hill. Yeah. plenty deer on the hills in these days, you know. That was really my life. I came here as a deer stalker. A good stalker takes them in as near as possible, gives them a comfortable position for the sake of the animal and for the sake of the gentleman. Give them a fair chance, and a fair chance to the animal. And it's very satisfactory when you do have a clean shot. Satisfactory for the animal and satisfactory for the rifle who's shooting it.
Well, when I came first, I thought, would I like to shoot a stag?
No.
Took me away up the hill. Got me in position, thought, no, but I couldn't do it. Couldn't do it. It was looking at me with such kind, big brown eyes, and I couldn't do it. We understood how I felt about animals. You know that I like all animals, so didn't want to kill it. So I didn't get the chance again anyway.
Slowly, slowly walk the path, and you might never stumble or fall. Slowly, slowly walk the path, and you might never fall in love at all.
American. Not a nice chap he was. Went out and shot the stag, you know, a clean shot. Tied my rope up, started to pull it home. He was walking on ahead of me and he stopped and he says, can I give you help with the stag? I said, yes, I said, you can. So he started to pull and he couldn't move it. He says, what the hell are you going to do with this carcass when you get it home anyway then? Oh, I says, my boss will get £15 for that. Well, he said, you cut off the head, all I want's the horns. He says, I'll give you a cheque for £15 and go home. You can give it to your boss. So I did that, and home I went with the head on my shoulder. Gave him a cup of tea, and away he went. And on the way back, and pulled the carcass home. So we had the carcass and the cheque. How was that?
Like the morning sun over fields of corn.
Times flew past. The glen was very quiet then. It seemed that the days seemed to be longer and the weeks seemed to be longer. There seemed to be more time to get things done.
I came here in 1953 and wanted to live in the hills. And there's a shepherd's job in Strathmore, and I became shepherd here.
The hills always had a great attraction for me, and I wanted not just to climb them, I wanted to work in the hills. I wanted a family life that it was very much a family life, with all the neighborliness that went with it, but at a distance, of course. At a distance that made the neighborliness of your own choosing. And it was only when the lorries and the diggers and the excavators arrived that you realized that the thing was crumbling. That was the end of a very important part of my life, and the end of a very important lifestyle for the Highlands.
My father was the head keeper here. There were more folk in the glen before the hydro came into it than there are now, and it was supposed to give work to the people of the Highlands. Most of the locals depended on getting season work, killing and that. And then when the hydro came in, there were big money. The wages in the hydro scheme were far beyond what they had been getting before. They wouldn't come back and work for the money that they used to get. They wouldn't come and live in the way that I had when I was young. Because life changed completely with the big money. But this is the thing, when I was young, we just helped. Everybody help one another. Never thought of getting paid for it. Nowadays, they won't do anything unless they get cash for it. This is what changed life, I think. And not for the better. I never wanted to leave that glen. I was quite happy. I would have spent my life in the glen, really.
Solitude is something that, if you're of a special mind, you enjoy. And I must say that I come to these places to be all on my own, because I find a quality of life, walking all on my own, that I can't get with anybody else's company. And I enjoy it. People call it communing with nature or enjoying wild places. Well, I think there's a little more than that to it, perhaps. You get some enjoyment from it that you find it difficult to share with anybody. Perhaps even there might even be an element of greed in it. But I could live here because I could entertain myself quite well, and I could walk on these hills all day, come back here at night, light a good fire, perhaps sit down here by the fireside, and I wouldn't be drinking exactly whiskey made by myself here, but I would think I would ensure that I had some close at hand. That would help to pass the time. And you could read here, I could play music here. There's a lot of things I could do to entertain myself, but I think this would be it would be the existence of a hermit. I don't think I could ask my wife to come here and live with me, because I know that her immediate answer would be, not on your life. There's no way she... people will come up and occupy summer cottages, but I think the day of people with families living in the glen is perhaps over. In a glen as isolated as this one is.
The world for us, of course, became a delightful one of rising at 10 o'clock in the morning and milking the cow. The days were very, very short, 10 o'clock till 3 o'clock in the afternoon. You had to have the chores of the day done by 3 o'clock. The frost would settle in and the fire would need to be well built up by 5 o'clock in the evening. And then you would sit for a long evening at the fire, reading or listening to the radio.
After 6 weeks stuck in the snow here in January 1943, I was quite happy. I had plenty of food for animals, and had a wireless of a kind there. That's about the only touch I had with the outside world. When the snow melted, a tramp came along. And I was that pleased to see him. I went down the road to meet him and shook hands with him. And he was an interesting chap. He asked me how I was faring, had I got a good season in the shooting, and how did the animals come through the winter? And I mean, I thought he was a down and out. He had an interest in our way of life, you see. And I never forgot it. Just different types of people that I met in my day.
Keeper once said to me, there's a spring bubbling out, a green spring bubbling out near the top of Strathmore Ground, over 3,000 feet. And he said to me, well, boy, if you take a drink from that spring twice a week, you'll live to be 100. The damming of the great Highland glens took away the alluvial flats from many of the great Highland valleys. The people that were either shepherding or keepering at the heads of these great glens went. The waters rose. The wildlife lost its habitat. The old inherited estates have been sold or chopped up, and new owners have come in on the heels of the once industrially orientated laird who made his money out of the Industrial Revolution. There were four shepherds in the glen. The sheep and the shepherds have gone, of course. Thank you.
who knew the glen before the hydro came, they would all tell you how much more wonderful it was, and I'm only thankful that I never saw it like that, because otherwise no one would always have the feeling that things aren't as they used to be, and I don't think that's a good thing. I had always been interested in the purchase of a first-class deer forest, and the first day I went up, it was sort of mizzly and wet, and the mist was right down, and I did manage to see one or two actually ridges opposite the lodge, but anyway, I fell in love with the place then, and we both decided that if we could buy it, we should, and we were fortunate enough to be able to do so. We bought it because it was very remote and a very peaceful place. My wife simply loves the countryside. People spend their money on holidays in the south of France, and I prefer to spend mine here. There is a great charm in being able to leave your car 6 miles away and go home in a boat.
I would say it was the finest piece of untouched Highland scenery in Scotland at that time. It seeped into you. And the beauty of the place was part of the sense of living here. You couldn't get away from the beauty of the place. It was with you every day, no matter what the weather was.
The first thing which really took our attention was the tremendous amount of work that had to be done on both the house and the surrounding area, where following the flooding, buildings had become derelict and semi-flooded, and I had to pull all these down and build a causeway.
But on the other hand, it had this extraordinary sort of remoteness and charm, and the house itself felt tremendously friendly, and I just felt that it was going to make a wonderful holiday home for us all.
You've got to be most economical. I can't read candles you're looking for.
There were all sorts of problems, like, you know, lamps, and you'd go into the store cupboard and it'd be pitch black, and you'd look for a light switch to begin with, and, you know, there wasn't one, so therefore you took a torch and things. It was really very difficult to begin with, but we didn't want to modernise it and put in electricity. One just wanted to keep it as it was, and now one's got much better at coping, and it's absolutely marvellous having candles and lamps and everything.
I think if you're very busy, to have a place to retreat to where you haven't got a telephone and you won't be worried by visitors is tremendously important, and it's a great place to relax, and you can get away from all the pressures of business life, and I certainly don't think it's romanticism coming here.
Place is finished. For me. The wholesomeness is gone. And that may be selfish. But for anybody that knew it, when it was a full working natural system, they could never come back to it. And sit under these conditions and live here again. I knew the balance that existed when I lived here. The balance of living here between low extraction of the natural resources and a caring for the hills. A caring hand of people that are sensitive to the wildlife, to the scenery, and to the people who live here is the most important thing. The old ways of life depended on subsistence and a very low standard of living. The old style is gone.
My father died in 1970, and I inherited the estate at that point. At that stage, it was a small highland estate run on traditional lines with a farming enterprise. I have it really made many changes. There was a herd of cattle, and when it came to replacing that a few years ago, that was when I decided to do something different.
This is the third year when my boss started the deer farming. Before, it used to stalk and shoot them, and now we're breeding them and feeding them. So I reckon he's taking a big risk on it. But he's willing to take a chance on these things, which, well, fair play to him. I just hope it works out. It's just the same as sheep and cattle. But if we had to actually kill them, I wouldn't like it, really. I'll go and stalk a deer on the hill and think nothing of it, but to kill them on the farm is a different thing. But I don't know. Maybe the deal come and we'll have to do it, but I'm not just too sure of how things will go.
I think diversification is probably the name of the game now. I have to think in terms of doing as many different things as possible on the farm to make the whole thing a viable enterprise in totality. If I went back to my grandfather's day, I could say that it was managed and run as a hobby.
One's got to look at the economics of the whole of this. You can't go into anything nowadays without having a go at the economics first. And certainly, here's a place where you could go in for a native pine wood scheme without fear. This would certainly grow good Scots pine.
The lower half of the glen is now a national nature reserve, and what is the main item interest in the glen is the preservation and regeneration of the ancient Caledonian pine forest, which covered the whole of the Highlands of Scotland.
Having a go at the economics first, and certainly here's a place where you could go in for a native pine wood scheme without fear. This would certainly grow good Scots pine.
The lower half of the glen is now a national nature reserve, and what is the main item interest in the glen generation of the ancient Caledonian pine forest, which covered the whole of the Highlands of Scotland.
We're charged in the Forestry Commission with enhancing the countryside. And, you know, I will spring to the Forestry Commission's defence and say that the countryside certainly looks better with the Forestry Commission than it would do without it. I mean, we hear people criticising the Forestry Commission left, right and centre. But let there be no doubt about it, the Forestry Commission has done a great job in the landscape. Enormous pressures on the Forestry Commission to satisfy a great range of demands by a lot of people. Some people want woods like this, other people like to wander among woods which are tall and straight and highly productive. So you've got to try and satisfy all the demands, and you'll never please everybody, of course. Thank you.
We get people coming on the hill, all their coloured coats and everything. And I was out with a gentleman one day, and we were just coming in on a stag, only stag we were likely to get that day. And a stag got up and bolted. I looked up, here was this hiker coming along. And he wasn't a bit apologetic. I says, "What do you do yourself anyway for a living?" "Oh," he said, "I work in an office." "Well, how would you feel if I walked into your office one day and scattered your papers off your table onto the floor?" "Oh," he says, "I wouldn't be a bit impressed," he said. "But," he says, "my desk is a considerably smaller area than your hill." He said, "You see, you had a point," did you know?
This was four cottages on the local estate, four farm workers' cottages. And I was a cattleman on the estate 30 odd years ago. The estate employed probably 20 people, if I remember rightly. But they're now serving the tourist industry. But I think behind it all, many of the local people are very, very sorry that their way of life has been changed, not necessarily at their own bidding.
The tourist is the new sheep in the Highlands. Ironically, the tourist wants to see the farmer, or the crofter, or the shepherd. But how do you pay to keep people quaint for the entertainment of the tourist?
My boss seems to be quite prepared to try to improve everything. And he's built the poor chalets and did up an old house as a holiday home. And that seems to be doing all right so far. But I was a bit weary at the time, you know, being could be a whole lot of strangers walking about them. That you never knew what they might be up to. But he seems to be quite successful, and that's long may it last, I'd say.
You can't stop the tourists. I would be the last to do that, because I would like to go and see parts of the country. I wouldn't go in and cause trouble, in the, you know, which a lot of them don't. They don't realise that they're doing any harm. It's just they like claiming hills and them.
Say I'm jack of all trades, master of none, and all my life I've no matter what job I've been doing, I've tried to take an interest in it, and there are jobs that I don't like, but I still like try to do them as to my best of my ability. My life was on the hill, and a good part of the time I was working on the farm, which I would. It's all right, but I would rather walk the hill.
Thing working in these areas was the friendship that one felt for the hills and the natural environment. and I knew the hills in all their moods, the grey winds of winter and the green winds of spring, and then the long blue days of summer. And the hills were content, so were we. We were shepherding on these hills, we were fit, and the freshness of the place, and the wholesomeness of the life. Aye, yes, we miss it. Interest in the past is only of value if you can learn from it. And maybe these areas have a great deal to teach us. But those that know about them and understood them are getting very scared.
If you talk to anybody who knew the Glen before the hydro came, they will all tell you how much more wonderful it was, and I'm only thankful that I never saw it like that, because otherwise, you know, one would always have the feeling that things aren't as they used to be, and I don't think that's a good thing.
I see myself partly as a conservationist, but remember, people have to make their living in the Highlands. And I think we should try and keep the few people that remain in the glens in them. We should aid them in some way. We shouldn't do anything really that will drive them out of there.
It could well be that shepherding will become a great tourist attraction. But there aren't many shepherds left. Shepherds are a thing of the past. Highlanders are romantic, who regrets the changes of the past and to some extent lives in the past. The Highlander really is a poetic man. He feels the hills, either in song or verse, or maybe in the way he speaks. And you add all these factors together, and in a 20th century world, of course, you can't live on them. So you adapt. With regret.
Duncan MacLennan. He once said something to me that he said after 38 or 40 years in the glen that he was able either to look at a stone or he could think of one which was distant. But there was a story tied up with each one of them. And it's only when you come to accept that all the small and tiny things and the rocks and the trees and every pebble on the shore of these places is important to you, then you will accept that you are part of what I would call the truly wild places.